Okay, now we're going to discuss the functions of the integumentary system. And most people think of it as fairly straightforward in terms of protection. Protection is one of the key functions of the integumentary system. However, it is certainly not the only function, and we'll go into quite a bit more detail in terms of the others. But we're going to start with protection first, because it is truly one of the most important functions. Now, first and foremost, I want to start our discussion talking about the proteins that are associated with the integumentary system, particularly with the most superficial layer, the epidermis. Now, in terms of the epidermis, you're going to have keratin protein. This is a very strong protein. It's going to provide the strength and the protection in that more superficial layer of the epidermis. We'll talk about that in great more detail in terms of the keratinocytes, which are going to synthesize or produce the keratin. Now, also in the epidermis, you're going to have lipids. Lipids are going to kind of secrete and be around the cells, kind of filling up that area between cells. It's important in terms of not allowing too much stuff in or too many things out of the integumentary system. So if you're thinking about jumping into a pool or getting into a shower, this is one of the main reasons why your body doesn't quadruple in size because of the water rushing into your body. So lipids are extremely important, particularly in terms of the epidermis. Now, in terms of glandular secretions, there's two main types. You're going to have sweat glands, which in terms of its anatomical term, it's really sudoriferous, but we'll say sweat glands here. And then oil glands. And these are sebaceous glands. We'll talk about these in great more detail, but sweat's going to play a big role in terms of thermoregulation, and oil will play a big role in terms of not allowing certain things to dry out in your body, particularly your hair. And lastly, and also of great importance, is the melanin pigment. And melanin is going to be synthesized in the melanocytes, which are located in the epidermis. So this is very important in terms of protection from UV radiation. It's going to cover up the nuclei of the keratinocytes within the epidermis and really serve as an important protection there. Now, another main function of the integumentary system is as a blood reservoir, and this is specifically within the dermal region, so the layer just deep to the epidermis, or what you can actually see. In a resting adult, about 10% of your blood is actually running through this area, so that's a considerable amount of blood. So this is going to serve as an important area. However, I want to note that in the epidermis, and this is something that I want to make clear because it's going to come up over and over again, the epidermis is actually avascular, which means that there is no blood supply in the epidermis. So all the blood supply, all the nutrients that you have in the epidermis has to come from the deeper dermal layer. All right. Also importantly, you're going to have a role in terms of thermoregulation. And this is going to, the integumentary system will play a role in various ways. First is in terms of sweat. You're going to sweat when your body temperature rises, and that will allow for cooling of the body. Also, as you can see in this visual, you're going to have what's referred to as vasoconstriction and vasodilation. Vasodilation means that the vasculature in the dermis will actually widen. And when it does that, that allows for more blood to move into that area. With the blood, you have the heat associated with the blood, and that will actually be lost through the epidermis. So you can think about when vasodilation will occur. Think about exercising. In some individuals, your face can get really red. That's what's occurring, vasodilation, so allowing for heat loss. Now, think about the opposite. If you're out in freezing temperature, your blood vessels will actually constrict and get smaller, so less blood is running through the dermis. So it's conserving all of that heat associated with the blood and allowing it to stay in the deeper layers. All right, another role in terms of thermoregulation is this last layer of the integumentary system, which is the subcutaneous layer. We also refer to this as the hypodermis. So this is going to be the deepest layer within the integumentary system. And one thing I want you to note in this visual is all of this yellow kind of blobby stuff, and that's fat, also referred to, a more scientific term, as adipose tissue. So adipose tissue serves as heat storage as well as energy storage. So depending on the individual, you can have more of the adipose tissue or less, but very important in terms of thermoregulation as well. All right, we'll discuss this in quite a bit more detail, but cutaneous sensation. Anytime you see cute, C-U-T, that indicates that you're talking about the skin. So cutaneous sensation having to do with receiving information from the external environment and integrating it through the central nervous system. So say something, you put your hand on a hot stove. You're going to have a signal within the integumentary system that's going to travel to your spinal cord, send a signal back telling you to remove your hand. So you have a fairly complex map in terms of sensory receptors in this area. So we'll talk about these maps in a bit more detail, but it's telling you which spinal nerve or cranial nerve is innervating that area. So excretion and secretion, as well as absorption, will play a big role in terms of the functions of integumentary system. So in terms of secretions, one of the main types of secretion is sweat. So those sudoriferous glands. You're going to have two different types of sweat glands. You're going to have eccrine sweat glands, which is what we typically think of when we're thinking of sweat glands. So the type of sweat that doesn't have much of a smell associated with it, what happens after you're exercising. And then you're going to have apocrine sweat secretions. And this happens with sexual excitement or extreme nervousness, things like that. This doesn't happen until after puberty. But these are two of the main secretion areas. Also, you're going to have lipid-soluble material, so when you're talking about oily secretions, so those sebaceous secretions, and we'll talk about that in quite a bit more detail later. Now, in terms of absorption, this can be either a very good thing or a very bad thing. So if you're thinking about topical steroids, so putting a topical steroid on your skin will allow for an anti-inflammatory reaction to occur, so something that can actually be prescribed or utilized when, particularly if something is very itchy, or it can be in a very bad thing. So if you think about poison ivy, this is being absorbed into your skin, into your integumentary system. So it can be a good thing and a bad thing in terms of absorption. The last function I want to discuss in terms of the integumentary system is the synthesis or the creation of vitamin D. So with UVB radiation from the sun, you're going to have the activation of a vitamin D precursor in the skin. This is going to start a process that's going to move through the liver and eventually finish in the kidneys to form the active form of vitamin D, calcitriol. Now, vitamin D plays a huge role, particularly in terms of the GI system, as well as in terms of immune function. So hopefully as we move forward, these functions are going to start making more sense. We're going to continue our discussion next with the layers of the epidermis and the cells. Then we'll continue into the deeper layers of the integument, so dermis and then hypodermis.